as well as freedom of assembly. We exercise our freedom of assembly here in our church on Mondays, praying and worshiping our God. But that freedom was challenged by the landlord of the building because our legitimate activities were considered a nuisance to other co-tenants. And as a result, we were banned. We have the right to contest and claim our right. But we know that we will be thrown out by eviction before we realize that that freedom also has limitation, which has also affected our freedom to socialize as a Christian community. In the same vein, man's freedom in the Garden of Eden was subjected to limitation, and man's human virtue to trust and obey simply God's commandment or instruction was put to test. Unfortunately, man has a bitter enemy who always appears to us as a friend, advisor, helper, partner, with sweet tongue and kind words, but is a wolf in sheep's clothing, looking for every opportunity to derail us, especially when we have found favor in the eyes of the Lord, and we are on the ladder to our greatness. When Satan cleverly slid us into the sin, his first action was to speak word, and his wicked word was designed to call into question or to challenge the very words of God. His first step is sowing the seed of doubt. Did God actually say that when you eat the fruit thereof, you will surely die? And the second step is the explicit accusation that the Creator was really a liar. As we read in Genesis 3:4-5, and the serpent said unto the woman, you shall not surely die. For God doth know that in the day you eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. When Adam and Eve rebelled against the only simple command, they realized they are holy and were ashamed because their eyes were open and realized that they were naked. And the eyes of them both were open, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves apron. It was word also that God used to call Adam. And it was also word that Adam used to express what is common with us, all of us today, fear. I was afraid. Shame. I hid myself. Blame. That woman who you gave me to be with me. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked. I hid myself. And he said, who told thee that thou wast naked? Hast thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that thou shouldest not eat? And the man said, the woman whom thou gavest to me to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I did eat. And it was word that Eve also put the blame on the serpent. And it was that word which God used to pass sentence on all humanity till today. Unto the woman he said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. In sorrow thou shalt bring forth children, and thy desire shall be to thy husband, and it shall rule over thee. Verse 16. And for man, and unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, and hast eaten of the tree of which I command thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it, cursed is the ground for thy sake. In sorrow shalt thou eat of it all the days of thy life. Thorns also and thistles shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat the herb of the field, in the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread, till thou return unto the ground, for out of it was thou taken, for dust thou art, and unto dust shalt thou return. What a price to pay for disobedience. And unfortunately, it's not only man today that is paying the consequences of our sin. Even we now have the women also walking now like men, putting two jobs together. Because it's no longer 100% responsibility, but 50-50. The man bringing 50, the woman bringing 50. What a shame. I thank God I don't have any wife. May God have mercy upon us. Amen. And forgive us and keep us from sin. Amen. Amen. After God created Adam, God gave Adam the privilege to name all the living creatures that he had created. And out of the ground, the love of God formed every beast of the field and every fowl of the air, and brought them unto Adam to see what he would call them. And whatsoever Adam called every living creature, that was the name thereof. And Adam gave names to all cattle, and to the fowl of the air, and to every beast of the field. Today, it is word. We used to name ourselves, our pets, and identify all things we use in life. So, be very careful when you are naming your children. Some people call them Alpha and Omega. Some people call them something junior, Thomas Junior. Don't make your children junior. If it's Thomas, let it be Thomas, but not junior. To remove junior from. Otherwise, he'll be junior all his life. Don't call your children Cain. Call him Abel, because we're Cain, the firstborn of humanity. Because of envy and jealousy, murder his brother Abel. God appeared to him and asked him, where is thy brother? And with words of denial, like most of us today, Cain said, I know not. Am I my brother's keeper? And it was with words that God pronounced judgment on Cain. Now let us examine the lives of few great men in the Bible. In Genesis 28:10-22, we read about Jacob, when God appeared unto him in a vision and promised him with blessing, as we read in verses 13. I am the Lord, the God of your father Abraham, and the God of Isaac. I will give you and your descendants the land on which you are lying. Your descendants will be like the dust of the earth, and you will spread out to the west and to the east, to the north and to the south. All peoples on earth will be blessed through you and your offspring. I am with you, and will watch over you wherever you go, and I will bring you back to this land. I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. When Jacob woke up, he placed the stone he used as a pillow on the spot where he saw the vision and made a vow to God. As we read in verses 20-22, and then Jacob made a vow saying, if God will be with me and will watch over me on this journey I am taking, and will give me food to eat and close to wear, so that I return safely to my father, to my father's household, then the Lord will be my God, and this stone that I have set up as a pillar will be God's house, and of all that you give me, I will give you a tenth. We also read about Moses, who was chosen by God to bring out the children of Israel from slavery out of Egypt. He was placed in a basket and left floating on the river where the daughter of King Pharaoh would come and bathe, but under the pavilions of his sister Miriam. It was also the word that God put into Moses' sister's mouth that changed the destiny of the children of Israel 80 years later. Then said his sister to Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and call to thee a nurse of the Hebrew women, that she may nurse the child for thee?" And Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Go." The maid went and called the child's mother. And Pharaoh's daughter said unto her, "Take this child away and nurse it for me, and I will give thee thy wages." And the woman took the child and nursed it. Can you believe this? When God is ready to bless you, He will use your bitter enemies to pull the chariot on which you will ride to occupy your position of honor, greatness, and authority. Just as He used Haman to proclaim the greatness of Mordecai, the Jew, before the whole Persians. God will use your enemy to bless you.
Amen.
Because we read it in Esther 6:6-10. And when Haman entered, the king asked him, "What should be done for the man the king delights to honor?" Now, Haman thought to himself, "Who is there that the king would rather honor than me?" So he answered the king, "For the man the king delights to honor, have them bring a royal robe the king had worn, and a horse the king had ridden, one with a royal crest placed on his head. Then let the robe and the horse be entrusted to one of king's most noble princes. Let them rope the man the king delights to honor, and lead him on the horse through the city streets, proclaiming for him, 'This is what is done for the man the king delights to honor.' Go at once." The king commanded Haman, "Get the rope and the horse, and do just as you have suggested for Mordecai, the Jew who sits at the king's gate. Do not neglect anything you have commended, you recommended. The grace of the Almighty will be your portion in Jesus' name."
Amen.
And back to Moses. 40 years later, after he was picked up from the river, where Moses was already comfortable in the palace of King Pharaoh, as possible here apparent, having been trained to succeed the king in case anything happened, God had another greater assignment for his life. The Spirit of the Lord led him to go and intervene between a Jewish slave and an Egyptian taskmaster, during which the Egyptian taskmaster died. One would have thought that the Jews would hail him as their champion and hero, but what happened? It was word from a fellow Hebrew in slavery that changed his destiny from Moses, future king of Egypt, to Moses, the liberator of the chosen people of God.
Amen.
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 Exodus 2:13-14. "And when he went out the second day, behold, two men of the Hebrews struck together, and he said to him that did the wrong, 'Wherefore smite thy brother, thy fellow?' And he said, 'Who made thee a prince and a judge over us? Intended thou to kill me, and thou killest the Egyptian?' And Moses feared, and said, 'Surely this thing is known.' So Moses fled Egypt to become a fugitive in the wilderness for 40 years. When Joshua sent his men to go and spy the walled city of Jericho, it was a harlot called Rahab, whom God used to fulfill his promise to the children of Israel. She protected them from being arrested by the king's soldiers, and in turn she used word to save the lives of her parents and her household from destruction by the Jewish armies who were about to invade her country. As we also read in Joshua 2:12-13, "Now therefore, I pray you, swear unto me by the Lord, since I have shown you kindness, that you will also show kindness unto my father's house, and give me a true token, and that you will save alive my father, and my mother, and my brethren, and my sisters, and all that they have, and deliver our lives from death. And the men also committed the whole armies of the God to Rahab. Verses 14. And the men answered her, our life for yours, if ye alter not this our business. And it shall be, when the Lord hath given us the land, that we will deal kindly and truly with thee. Do we really have such people of integrity among our leaders today? Once they get what they want from us, they readily betray their trust. Even in the church today, Christians make pledges and vows to God. And because nobody is chasing after them to fulfill their pledges, they feel, who will query us? I need my money for something else. That was why Apostle Peter asked Ananias, when he saw his land, but connived with his wife to keep back part of the sales money. And Peter said unto Ananias, why? Has Satan